Well, greetings everybody. Brother Dan Goodwin here. You're watching Prophecy in the News, and I'm coming to you from my studios in Kentucky, and I'm going to take you to the studio at Oklahoma City for the interview in just a moment. I want to introduce the show to you and tell you what the show is going to be about today. You're not going to want to change that dial. You're going to want to listen to every minute. I've got a very interesting guest in the studio, and we're going to be talking about the days of Noah. And we're going to be talking about the great deception that's happening in our ministries right now, in our churches. I'm telling you, and it's not coming from the outside, sad to say. It's not coming from the world. It's not coming from politics. It's coming from our very own prophecy ministries and some of our mainline churches, and some of the big name preachers out there are just spreading stuff that just isn't biblical whatsoever. We're going to be talking in the show today about deceiving and being deceived. The Bible says that we'll in the last days, men shall be deceived, and there'll be deceivers out there. We're in that day, friend. We're going to be talking about why we won't get back to old-fashioned Bible prophecy. Instead, we're talking about Nephilim, sons of God, Book of Enoch. We're going to tell you about the Book of Enoch and why you better be very careful about the Book of Enoch. We're also going to discuss the Book of Jude, verses 6 and 7. So I want to take you to the studio. Now, I got a great guest with me, and we're going to get the show going. So here we go. I have sitting with me my guest, Brother Charles Hiltibidal, Dr. Charles Hiltibidal, my good friend from Illinois. Sir. You live just a couple hours from my house. And we've got you working all day here today at Prophecy News. We're here in the beautiful studios here. And we've done a couple of shows with you. We did a couple of YouTubes. And now we're not last, but we're doing our God's Final Jubilee show with you. And you have two DVDs that we've been talking about in our shows. You got a brand new one just come out, The Gap Theory, Fact or Fiction. And by the way, those of you who watch me often, you know, I am not a gap theory guy. I do not believe in a gap of millions of years between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2, and neither does this guy, and he's got a great DVD set. There are two DVDs in here, and I don't have any of these, but Prophecy News does. You can order these straight from prophecynews.com. Rex will put that up on the screen for you. Second one, we're going to talk about this a little bit in our show here today, as in the days of Noah. Let me read a verse for you. And by the way, both of these are available on the website at prophecynews.com. they're not on my website, so don't go to my website. Go to Prophecy News if you'd like to order these. They got a good deal on them there. I want to read a verse, and then I'm going to turn you loose about this days of Noah. Because there's a lot of confusion today.
Yes, there is.
Unbelievable, the confusion and the craziness that's going on out there. But look what it says here in Matthew 24, verse 36 and 37. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Notice he said the angels of heaven. How come he didn't say the sons of God?
Mm.
If the sons of God are angels, how come he didn't say not the sons of God of heaven?
They're servants.
Yeah. But my Father only. Then verse 37, but as the days of Noah, as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. In the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered in the ark. Now, there's nothing wrong with any of those things he mentioned there, but the point was they weren't watching. They were living their lives like there was no God. You're saying it goes further than that. The Bible talks about the wickedness and the violence in the age. Now, here's what I want you to tell us, and this is in your DVD here, most of it. We are being told today that Genesis 6, fallen angels fell out of the sky, fallen angels. And they say they're called sons of God. I don't believe that. But they're saying these sons of God, which they say are fallen angels, came down, mated with human women. Children were born of them. They corrupted the whole human race, every single human being. Now, maybe not everybody believes that, but that's what's being taught today.
Yes.
They're saying that every human being on the face of the planet, except for 8 people that got on that ark, were infected and corrupted by these devils so that they no longer had a soul, couldn't be saved. God had to kill them all. And he saved these 8 people, not because they were saved, but because they were not corrupted with the DNA of Satan. And so, but even of the eight, one of them was corrupted, and God missed him.
Yeah.
Now, you know, one of Noah's
Ham's wife, they think.
Okay. And so God missed one, and so Ham's people are corrupted, and it starts all over again. And now you got books being written, the return of the Nephilim, and all this stuff.
Yeah.
I don't believe that. You don't believe that.
No.
Now I want you to tell us your view on this. What was this all? What happened that brought about the flood, in your opinion?
In my opinion, what brought about the flood was what he pointed out about the wickedness of men, and that their hearts was wicked, only evil continue.
This is in Genesis 6.
The thoughts of their heart was evil only continue. The imagination of their minds was all evil continually. To the subject of fallen angels, certainly there are fallen angels. The Bible said a third part of heaven's host fell in rebellion with Lucifer. Some believe, and it would appear that Lucifer himself might have been at least one of the cherubs, one of the highest in the order of authority, and a third of heaven's host followed him in rebellion. They left their first estate. They didn't leave their estate of their being. they no longer have their address in heaven. I have an estate in southern Illinois. It's 8820 County Road 850 North. I'm not there right now. I'm here. But so a lot of people seem to think that somehow or another fallen angels had an ability to impregnate earthly women and produce children with them. Well, there's several flaws in that. Number one, angels are created outside of the realm of time. They do not have flesh and blood. The Bible says flesh and blood does not inherit the kingdom of heaven. A lot of people call them sons of God, but the Bible refers to them as servants, messengers, always sons of God.
Ministering spirits, I believe, ministering is one of the phrases.
And the term sons of God is always in reference to believers. Of course, the Lord spoke to the religious crowd and said, "You're of your father, the devil." That's not talking about physically from the devil, but spiritually.
And I say it a little rougher than you say it on my show. Folks will tell you, I say, does that mean that the Satan or one of his angels showed up at your mother's house before you were born and had relations with her, and now he fathered you? You got to be kidding me.
Yeah. Well, another reason, it requires the blood in with the seed when it's applied to the egg in the mother's womb.
So we have a problem here.
We got a problem because there's no blood involved. No woman has a seed either, as you well pointed out. So Genesis 3:15 is speaking spiritually or figuratively in types of events concerning prophecy about redemption. Well, people need to understand the Bible is all about redemption. It doesn't tell us all the dark things about sin. It tells us all the good news about redemption. And so this idea that fallen angels cohabited with the women of the earth, it would be an impossibility because we cannot reproduce outside of our own kind.
And that's a biblical principle in the very first chapter of the Bible.
It is the very first scientific principle laid out in the week of creation. And the very first time you find a principle of science. Now, verse 1 is going to give you five things that scientists need to operate with, but it's not until day 3 that we are informed of the first principle or law of science that has never, ever changed, and that is that everything produces after its kind.
A tree can't bring forth a flower.
No.
And a dog can't mate with a cat. I mean, we all knew this when we were kids.
Yeah.
I think folks don't farm. People don't grow up on farms anymore. They don't understand common.
Everybody wants
simple
to put something into the Bible rather than getting something out of the Bible.
Yeah.
And you're right. Most people, they think that They think that milk comes from the grocery store. They didn't know it had to come out of the cow in the field who ate green grass and through its three digestive systems finally produced. But anyway, I grew up on a farm. When I was just a boy, 7, 8 years old, I was helping my dad draw milk every morning. So.
Well, it takes a bull, right?
It certainly does.
It takes a bull. You got to have a bull on the farm.
That's right.
If you're going to have any little baby calves.
And not only that, if you're going to have milk, you've got to have a calf born.
Yeah.
And for a few months after that, milk continues to flow if you keep the process going. But back to the subject, fallen angels are entities outside of time. Our bodies are created temporary inside the realm of time, and it is not a possibility of foreign DNA from outside of time to have had an ability to produce anything of a DNA inside of time.
Now, Ephesians chapter 6 is important here, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
We wrestle not against flesh and blood.
And
he's talking about angels. Huh. He's talking about the fallen angels. That we call them demons, but you know the word demon is not in the King James Bible.
No.
I don't have a problem people using it. I still slip and use it. The words devils is the word, the biblical word. He calls them devils.
Yeah.
But that's fine if people want to use the word demon, that's fine, as long as they understand it's not a biblical
and
word.
We have no idea how many, because the Bible tells us of the creation of the angels, it's an innumerable host.
Yeah.
So are we talking about thousands? Are we talking about millions? Are we talking about billions? I don't know. He said it's an innumerable host.
Okay.
But only a third of them are fallen.
So if they're not flesh and blood, then how could they procreate with a human
being? It cannot happen. It's impossible.
Now, the other side will say, well, these are fallen angels. They have powers. And so somehow they have miraculous powers.
Well, the devil demonstrated he had power to affect Job, but he did not have power to take his life. And so the fallen world has power. They didn't lose those power, but their power has never been above whatever God set the boundaries
now,
to.
Ezekiel, in the day that thou was created, that's speaking of Satan.
Yeah.
And it would be the other angels as well.
Right.
So he's a created being.
Yes.
So does
he have
the power?
A lot of people think that means created inside of time, but...
Right. He's not.
No.
He was not created in Genesis at
no.
all. He's created outside of our universe.
God was already in operation by time standard long before time began.
I think people misunderstand Genesis 1:1. In the beginning.
That's talking
in the beginning
about our
doesn't
creation.
Mean the beginning of God or the beginning of heaven.
No.
It's in the beginning of our 7,000-year period of time here.
It's in the beginning of this world in which we live. It's where God placed man in a utopian world. Before God did all kinds of things before day 3 to make it a utopian environment. In other words, the most perfect environment without sin. I'm convinced if you understand the geology of the world and you understand, let's say, Plutonium 238 or 242, whatever numbers you want to give, and they say, well, that means it's been around for 243 million years. No, it doesn't. It was designed to still at 243 million years of time still have its half its energy mass. It's obvious that the way the world was designed in its original creation, it would have been an atomic power plant for perpetuality. Sin is what broke all of that up when the devil brought sin and tempted even Adam. So the creation week, all of that was God making a perfect world. And then he put the world together, the landmass and the river system with the seas around it. Then he put the fishes and he put the birds. Then he put the air-breathing animals and the creeping things on the earth. Got it all done, and then he said, now all of this is for one purpose. I'm going to make man made in my image and give him all of this.
Don't you wish Noah would have slapped one of the mosquitoes that got on board? Just one of them. Just one of the
two. It wouldn't have taken but one, would it?
Yeah, and that'd been it. But
yeah.
Now, of course, they're telling us the sons of God are fallen angels. They get that because they go to Job 1,
yeah,
and they see sons of God. Now, I think you agree with me. I believe, and I've taught this for a few years, I can't prove it, but I'm pretty sure I believe the sons of God, and I believe Job 1 is talking about paradise. I believe God met with the saints in paradise from time to time. Now, not face to face, because they don't have their glorified body yet.
But that's where Jesus went between crucifixion and resurrection.
Yeah.
Resurrection, that's where he went.
I believe that that's where they're at, and Satan showed up. Now, somebody on my page brought this up. This isn't original to me. Somebody on my page brought this up. They said, Brother Goodwin, if those are angels in Job 1, and then the Bible says, and Satan also came among them, why would he be singled out? He'd be just like the rest of them. They're all angels.
Yeah.
But yet he was singled out like he was something different
right.
than the sons of God mentioned there.
Yeah.
I believe the sons of God, all 11 times, and I did a study on this, and it'll be in my new book. One chapter will be on each of the 11 times. I'll explain all 11 times that it's used. Every time that it's used, I believe it's talking about the redeemed,
yes,
people
sir.
Who have
believers.
Trusted the Messiah. Only 11 times in the Bible. Of course, the most famous, John 1:12,
as right.
many as received him, to them gave he the power to become yes, the sons of God,
right.
even to believe on his name. Now, what folks are telling me, folks are saying, yeah, but Brother Good, in the New Testament, sons of God are people who are saved. They say in the Old Testament, they're angels. Now, that's not, that's
well,
just
I thought
not.
The, I thought it was an entire Bible.
Yeah.
I thought it all, no, that's not true.
The law of first mention. The yes. first principles.
Yes, sir.
First time something's mentioned, the,
yes,
the definition, the principle.
God
the,
does it. God is uniform.
Yeah.
And God doesn't jump all over the place. He doesn't change his mind. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
You know, if those were angels, and I've got a whole study on this. We won't get into it here, but I went through verse by verse, Genesis 6, 1 through 8. The very first verse says, in those days, men began to multiply. What's the theme of the whole passage?
Yeah.
Men
it's
multiply.
The multiplication. It's the populating of planet Earth.
Yep. And then it says, the sons of God and the daughters of man. If that was angels, why didn't God said the angels went into the daughters of
mm-hmm.
men? Why didn't it say that?
Yeah.
Didn't sons of God. Now, we understand
well,
what
God
sons
doesn't
of God.
Call them his son. God, they're ministering spirits. They're servants. He only has one son, and through his one son, he now has many sons.
Right. And we're and
because of birth.
And Hebrews 1:5 says that,
Hebrews.
Right?
Yes. I don't understand why people come out, but it's sensational, Dan.
Under which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son?
My son.
They're not.
None.
And I realize in the context there, he's talking about the begotten.
Now, there are,
that.
You know, there's religions out there. There's belief systems that call themselves Christians, more than one, that believe that Lucifer and Jesus were brothers.
Yeah.
Well, that by no means taught, found anywhere in the Bible, nor is it the truth.
No.
You can put into the Bible a whole lot of things that's not in it.
Now, I don't know how many people said, Brother Gunn, you need to read the Book of Enoch. What's your take on the Book of Enoch?
Who knows if it's actually the Book of Enoch? We have many other testaments. There's all kinds of testaments. Last I knew, there was 40 or 50 of them out there by different people credited. They can't prove that they were even written by them. But that's not what the book of Jude even talks about. It doesn't say he wrote a book. It said he was a preacher of righteousness.
I had a guy write to me on Facebook, or maybe it was YouTube. He said, Brother Gunnerin, are you saying Jude lied? Jude said that Enoch wrote a book. And I wrote him back. I said, no, he did not. And he got very upset with me.
Yeah.
And then he said, well, it doesn't come out and say that, but he insinuates it. So he changed his view a little bit. And here's what it says. In Jude chapter 1, verse 14, and Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. Now, that's the second coming at the end of the tribulation.
That's right.
Enoch prophesied of that. It doesn't say he wrote a book. It doesn't say he wrote anything.
But you need to understand what that verse is telling you. The key to that verse is when it says the seventh from Adam. Go back, take the seventh from Adam, put it on top of the lineage of Cain, and you know what you'll find? Lamech's world in chapter number 4.
Hmm.
And so what he's pointing out is this righteous preacher was standing against the Lamech's world. And if you read chapter 4, you find 17 character traits of the culture of the time in Lamech's world. He justified himself for killing a man that tried to kill him. He justified having two wives, polygamy. The list goes on down the line. And here's what's being taught in Jude. If Enoch can stand against a Lamech's world and preach the righteousness of God, in our day, we can stand against the unrighteous world and still proclaim the truth.
Wow, that's good.
But you trace it. That's why it says the seventh from Adam. That brings you to Lamech.
Yeah. Boy, everybody's confused in the book of Jude.
Yes, sir.
Not only with Enoch here, but verse 6 and 7. They try to tie verse 6 and 7 together. They don't go together.
No, they don't.
The angels in verse 6, which kept not their first estate, it's heaven, but left their own habitation, their dwelling place in heaven. He hath reserved an everlasting change of darkness unto the judgment of the great day. There is absolutely nothing in that verse that refers back to Genesis 6. And there's nothing in Genesis 6 that refers back forward to this. Nothing. It's speculation. But then they go to verse 7, and here's where it gets bad. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah, this is verse 7, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Are set forth for an example of suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. They tie verse 7 into verse 6, meaning trying to insinuate that the angels are the strange flesh here and that some kind of union took place.
You need to tie verse number 7 back to Romans chapter number 1.
Yes.
The natural affection.
The strange flesh is men with men.
Natural affection is laid aside.
So this will be a chapter in my new book. I'll deal with Jude, but... it's just unbelievable in our day. So here we are, a remake of the days of Noah, when there's wickedness everywhere.
Absolutely.
Imaginations of men's hearts.
That's it.
And what's going on in prophecy circles? Fairy tales and sci-fi stuff.
But it's sensational, and it piques the interest of our natural man. And be real honest with you, the greater majority of born-again people are carnal. We're not really spiritual. We have all of the media, all the technology, everything to make our life so much better that we have no time to meditate or actually study the Word of God. So what's sensational to us, I mean, I'll have to be honest, I like to watch a good entertaining action movie.
Sure.
But I understand that's just fiction. It's not real. But still, it appeals to that old nature. And so if I can find a way to appeal to the old nature and make it appear to be spiritual, I got a good crowd.
Well, Doc, in the last 6 or 8 weeks, I have heard that Merlin the magician was a fallen angel. I've heard that Abraham, the reason he was concerned about his wife Sarah not having a baby, he was concerned that when he died, he's going to be buried under the floor of his house. And they drill a hole in the floor and they pour water down. I'm serious. This was on a national television.
They didn't live in a house. They lived in a tent that moved.
Well, under the floor.
Well, they did dig him up and move him every time.
Abraham would be buried under the floor, and they drilled a hole and put a tube in there, and one of the children had to feed him. Well, if he didn't have any children, so that's what he was worried about. This was on a show. I heard that fallen angels or spirits are flying around in UFOs of some sort, and people are seeing them. I mean, where does this end? This just goes, it's unbelievable.
Well, that's part of the end time deception, Dan. That's part of the end time deception.
And the worst thing I heard was when one guy sat there and said that the seventh word of the King James Bible was in error, the word heaven, and that in the originals it's plural. Well, there are no originals. You know that.
No.
There's no original Hebrew anywhere on planet Earth. There wasn't in Jesus' day. They lasted maybe 100 years, those originals. There's no originals. And so what does he mean? The originals say this, therefore the King James is. What is he comparing it to?
Well, we like to be, I've discovered in all the years of ministry, we like to put ourselves in authority over the Scripture. We don't want to submit to the authority of the Scripture.
Doesn't that make you a pope? When you look at the crowd and you say, folks, your Bible's wrong here, it needs to be this, don't you become the Pope? I got out of that.
I have a hard
1981. I got out of that.
I have a hard enough time living in submission to the Scripture. I don't need to usurp my authority over the Scripture.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, I guess we've probably made enough people mad today.
Well.
And listen, it ain't about making people mad. It's about
the truth.
Getting the truth out there.
It's the truth. I learned a long time ago is when you take a stand for right and righteousness, you need to understand there's going to be more people not like you than like you.
Yeah.
But it's still my responsibility to say the truth. I don't say it in order to make people mad. I'd say it because it's the truth.
They used to tell Lester Roloff, they said, Brother Roloff, you're rubbing the cat the wrong way. You remember what he said?
Turn that cat
Turn
around.
Turn the cat around.
That's right.
Yeah, and like I said, was it this show I talked about preaching? Maybe that was the last show. I can't remember. We've done so many shows today. I said the prophecy world, I think most of them aren't used to preaching.
No.
Because people said, boy, you sound angry, Brother Goodwin. It's preaching.
Yeah.
And the difference in teaching and preaching, and I'm all for teaching, the difference in teaching and preaching is Jesus spoke as one who had authority.
As rightly.
What was he doing? He's preaching.
Yep.
And when Jeremiah preached,
yeah,
they get mad at him.
That's right.
Because preaching is not just teaching what you think the Bible says. Preaching is saying, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
And
well, this is the authority, and we need to come back to it. One of the problems with it seems like a prophecy ministries in our day, and I'm not throwing all of them in the same bag by any means. There's some good people
sure.
out there, some good folks. But it seems like we've gotten away from Bible prophecy. Out into inserting all kinds of our ideas and thoughts into it rather than just letting this be Bible.
Yeah, I'm with you. Well, I guess on that note, Doc.
Amen.
Thanks for
Thank you.
Letting me abuse you all day today.
Enjoyed
and,
our time
We've
together.
Done five shows today, I think, with you. And you'll probably never come back. I've worked you like a dog. And my producer back there, Rex, he's got to edit all these.
Yeah. Give him something to do.
Yeah, yeah. So he sleeps back there. I can't see him through the glass. There he is. He's awake back there. But he's ready for lunch. He's on the phone right now trying to find a job somewhere else, if he's smart. And welcome back to my studio here in Kentucky. I hope you enjoyed the show. I hope you really hope you got something out of it. These are troubling times. This is a time of great deception. And, I know I ended on a little humorous note there, but, you know, salvation is not, there's nothing humorous about salvation. I hope you know where you're going when you die. I hope you've been born again, my friend. If not, contact us. We'd love to help you with that. Love to send you some material. But until then, keep your eyes on the skies and keep looking up.